morning, Zsolt. How are you?
Perfect for Halloween.
Perfect for Halloween. It's not morning where you are, is it?
It's kind of. It's 9 o'clock, so.
Ah, wow. Oh, where are you?
Philadelphia.
That's right. I forgot. I keep thinking. Yeah, the accent throws me every time. Whenever I hear an accent, I just assume somebody's in a different country. But I forgot you're based in the U.S.
No, I've been working on the accent for 47 years now. I'm almost perfect with it.
I hear that if you just watch a lot of John Wayne movies, it helps get rid of your accent.
I'm sure. I don't know. I'm watching Westworld. It didn't help.
It didn't. Yeah, well, that wasn't. Well, you know. Hey, I guess any show with some good. Or I don't know if good acting is what I meant to say, but any acting with American accents is helpful, and I guess that's good to go. But hey, everybody, welcome to the chat too. You're watching Instructional Designers in Offices drinking coffee, and I hope you all have your coffee in hand. I know Zsolt and I both do. And for those of you who do not know who's sitting with me, Chris, I don't believe is going to be with us today. And I totally had forgotten about that. It's really kind of a bummer. I love hanging out with Chris on Wednesday mornings, but it's just going to be me today chatting with Zsolt Olah. Did I say that right?
Sounds like Starbucks.
Yeah.
You know, in Starbucks, they ask you for your name.
Come on. I've got to do at least better than the barista.
All right. So, yeah, it was perfect. I would just like myself, would say.
Well, thank you. But, yeah, for those of you that are hanging out in the chat, first of all, thank you for hanging out with us this morning. This is always a fun conversation Wednesday mornings. It's a little early for the West Coast, but 9 a.m. for the East Coast, which is fantastic for everybody that joins us from there. But the UK, too. Hello, Lightbulb Joe. Thanks for hanging out with us. 2 p.m. in the UK. All right. Oh, no, 1 p.m.? Okay. You know, what's funny is that in November, it switches to 7 o'clock for me, so I don't have to wait so long because the time zone thing changes, but I live in Arizona, and Arizona ignores the whole daylight savings time thing, so I just shift time zones without even having to move. It's very strange, but it's just the way it works. But anyways, folks, great to see you all. If you don't know Zsolt Olah, Zsolt, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
So my name is Zsolt, which is pretty cool here and very common in Hungary, where I'm originally come from. So when you see this name, you know that the person is from Hungary. More than that, actually, we have a name day. So if you want to celebrate with me, April 10th, it's the Zsolt Day. So all the Zsolts go out and celebrate and
drink. Oh, you're kidding. So I need to have a Brent Day. What the
heck? I'm sure there's one.
There's got to be one.
All right, so anyway, so that's my quick story. I'm from Hungary. 20 years in this industry, L&D. And I have to say I'm an addicted to creativity. And then this is one of the reasons why I wrote the book, because I had to decide whether I'm going to hurt people or write a book, and things like that was an easier way to get out of the creativity pressure.
Yeah, for sure. And the book is great. You know, I was scanning through the website, and it reminded me, I was looking at the name of the main character, and it just dawned on me. How did you come up with that name?
So one thing that I tried to come up with 12 things to say today, why not? You should not read this book or buy it. So I have a lot of reasons. So one is that it's not a typical book that you would read and suddenly you know how to do micro learning or something like that. And everything in this book is something, every tiny little thing has a reason. So this guy up front is Lido, and that's the guy's the last ID on Earth. Okay. So the name LD and the whole Lido, the letters come from the last ID on Earth, as this person who used to be an ID go through a digital transformation and finds themselves in this weird world, and then now it becomes more like a chatbot type of approach. In fact, I gave up the whole like her and he kind of thing. It's switching all over in the book.
Oh my gosh, that's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah, I was going to say, you as an author, there had to be a reason behind it. So I'm glad I asked, because it makes perfect sense now for sure. So what triggered you? I mean, besides the fact that you love being creative, what triggered you to write a book like this?
So it started out with, I think, a year and a half, 2 years ago, Shannon Tipton had this crazy idea that maybe we should write a blog for 80 days every single day or something, which sounds interesting when you start, but on week 4 or 5, every Saturday, Sunday, it's hard to write something that actually makes sense. And when it was done, she was joking like, well, this is half of a book. And I said, okay, what's the other half then? Because I could write a book. That was kind of like the trigger of all these memories, learning events in my past. And then the challenge of, is there any way to put these absolutely random things out of my mind into one cohesive way? There wasn't, so I just wrote the book.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome. So you got 12 reasons for people to not buy your book, you said. Let's jump.
Yeah. So one is that you might not find it absolutely intriguing all the way through. So as Tom Coleman, when he read the book, he said, like, you know what? It's interesting. It's almost like I sit down with you with a coffee and have a chat. And it's like, yeah, exactly like that. So it's not going to have well-structured table of contents as you go through, supporting ideas, research, all of that. It's a story on two levels. But if I have to sum it up, basically what I wanted to do is change your breathing. There's this quote in the book in the beginning from Donald Taylor said that, actually I'm going to read this because I'm going to butcher probably the quote, but he said, learning is like breathing, superficially understood, yet fundamentally complex and essential to life. So I figured that my goal is to change your breathing. The moment you start even thinking about your breathing, you're actually changing your breathing. The same with learning. It's not about tools and processes and steps in the book, but more about thinking very differently about what you do as an instructional designer and what happens in the future. Is it still valuable? Is it something that you can use in 5, 10 years kind of thing?
I love it. That's a great quote, and it's a great way to think about it. I've heard Donald mention that before, actually, in some of his presentations, or at least when he's leading off events and whatnot. But yeah, it is like air and breathing, and you're right. It's like, and until you really think about it, you don't really change your breathing unless you think about it, because it's so automatic. And I could see learning being exactly the same way. We just sort of do it all the time. And we have assumptions that, well, if I read a book or if I watch a video, that I'm automatically I'm learning that I'm automatically, you know, consuming it and I'm going to remember it. But I think we all have had the experience of trying to recall something even short a day or so later and not being able to get it 100% accurate, or just not even remembering what you had. Yeah. So you have to work at it, and there's tricks to it. Do we learn a little bit about that in the book too?
So the idea of this digital thing, and then there's this whole like subtitle of that, again, I forgot my own subtitle, but it's basically a brain picking memoir from a creative digital strategist. It's a little bit sarcastic, obviously, about just digital transformation and strategy. Back then when I started writing this, there was not a clear definition of what everybody talked about, digital transformation and that. So, but McKinsey just came out, I think, a couple of weeks ago with their piece on how digital transformation and strategy is killing organizations because there's a lack of clarity about what it is. But what I found interesting in that one that relates to my book is that there are kind of three reasons they're swirling. One is that not only they don't know what the digital part is, but they underestimate the pace of change and the scale of change. Right. And with these two things in learning, you have the same idea. I talk to instructional designers who are trying to figure out whether on page 10, the graphics should be on the left or on the right, and which one looks better. And I always, that reminds me of this fear of, am I going to be replaced by a robot? And I think you will, because AI is going to take this over, and much easier and faster overnight creates what we're trying to build when our decision is about whether left or right or text flows if left or right or under.
If that's what people think instructional design is, then yes, they will be out of a job very quickly.
So in the book, you have
that choice much faster and more accurately.
Well, this is part of it, but I think there is, it's because you're in the trenches of things and you can't even come up for breathing again, back to the breathing part. The book doesn't mention any of those instructional design strategies and all that. It's almost like if you take a break from instructional design and just come up for the world and look around what's happening, what are those six areas that you might want to know more about and learn in order to be a resilient when this change is happening?
Yeah. Yeah. That's a great, that's a great point for us to make today. I think overall is to, I think everybody needs to kind of lift their head up out of their instructional design world a little bit and see really how people are doing things and starting to shift our thoughts and our ideas of how we do what it is that we do. I know for some of us, the knee-jerk reaction is to dig our heels in and to be even stronger and more devoted to our past and to the traditions of instructional design. But I think I think as I look at everything that's changing, it feels a little strange, these new digital transformations and the different ways that people are consuming content. But it's actually really liberating in my mind. It gives us so many more options to do the things that we do effectively. And I think we just have to engage and start thinking about what we can do differently, right?
Yeah, I mean, it is scary in one way because you you think you learned something, you learned a trade, you learned a tool, and you're ready to go out there. And this is, again, one of the McKinsey findings that we're just blurring now the borderlines of industries. So like I used to work for Comcast for 9 years. It started out with we had only competitors in the cable industry. Now it's all over because everything is streaming. There's Netflix, there's Amazon, like whoever has anything. There's no like video anymore versus I turn on the TV. I have no clue what it's streaming or not or where it's coming from. Yeah. So the same with learning, we used to have this bubble of I'm going to take your content and create something engaging and put it out there and we're done. But the business doesn't care about that part. They actually care about the people who work there and with their... Are they doing what they're supposed to be doing or not? What do you do in between is up to you. But if you only have one tool and one method and you don't learn, you don't unlearn and learn, it's going to be a hard next decade.
Yeah, it's interesting. Sue drops an interesting point in the chat about something I mentioned earlier. She said it even applies to the Devlin conference she just left. And Zsolt and I were both there too, but you know, it's interesting that we as instructional designers also still utilize old school methodology for our events, and we expect and people expect to go to our events. So you would think that we would be better at doing educational events and educational sessions. And, you know, if any industry is going to have a better event where people are going to walk away and learn and actually remember everything that they do, you know, you would think that our industry would be the first to change that and to make it better. So there's a bit of irony in that.
Yeah. Whenever I hear that, there's, what they call it, the theater seating, when there's lots of chairs and people sit down and then it's really hard work for a presenter to make that move, like, hey, we're gonna work them together on something. I mean, it's possible, but it's it always comes down to the creativity of the facilitator, of how we can change that the atmosphere.
It's complicated. All I know is that every time I go, I come home with the Devlin plague and I'm sick for a week or two afterwards. So I apologize for my coughs and sniffles, everybody. It's
the people. You shouldn't talk to too many people because they're carrying all these germs.
Yeah, the shaking of hands. I didn't get the hand sanitizer on at just the right times. You know, that's odd. It started to feel like there was a real social issue with using hand sanitizer, because if you just meet a few people and they're still hanging around the booth and the next thing you do is walk behind the booth and grab some hand sanitizer, it seems kind of rude to those people that you just engaged with, like, oh man, I better sanitize my hands now. I don't know. I'm trying to work on that. Maybe I should be more stealthy about it. If anybody has any tips, that would be good to know. But
I'm sure the digital transformation is going to change that. It's going to be automatic. I don't know.
Yeah, we're all virtual.
Invisible.
Right? We all get to learn from each other just having a conversation, right? So, this is the future, you know, hanging out and talking with your peers and the communal aspect of social learning, as they say. So,
yep. All about people.
Yeah, well, let's jump into some of those more specific strategies that people have either told you that you've learned from them or that you expect people to take away from the book that they can go out and apply right away. What can we tell people about that part?
Yeah, so, and I don't want people to get the impression that this is a serious book, because so far what we talked about is a real serious topic of change and fear of how this is going to change our lives and how do I, as an instructional designer, survive. That's not the tone of the book. Completely the opposite. It's almost like a sarcastic way of looking at what the world is. But I do have, in every chapter, I have at the end a little bit of a what do I learn from this, and then some IRL challenges, so the in real life challenges. So if you learn about critical thinking, for example, one of those shields, we kind of talk about what it is, why is it good for us, what does that mean in real life. So we're not getting into theories, not getting into tons of pages about abstract notions, but what can I do, five things now that maybe help me, and see if is this something that I can use for something in my work. Just thinking about how you think. And this is a theme that's recurring in the whole book. In fact, when this little guy, Lido, enters this world through the magic class, just Lewis Carroll's magic, or through the looking glass, it's through the looking class.
I love that.
The first thing this character learns or unlearns is that he or she can't move physically until his mind is there. So it's literally like you have to relearn of what you do. It's all about the mindset first, and then the tools and the action. So all these little things it's kind of funny in the book and sometimes absolutely bizarre. I guarantee that you're not going to understand the whole thing. In fact, at the end, when you get through these six shields, you think that you come to like an end when all comes together and it's like all makes sense. No, it won't. But it's going to definitely change how you think about the world. And so one of them was critical thinking. The other one is how do you use social impact? So is it okay that once a year you go to a conference, sit in a room and maybe have lunch with someone, and that's your social network about an industry, and that's the only thing that you do? Because there are people who can afford once to come to this conference, but they never ever do anything social. They don't understand what the business is about. They just do their own thing and learn one thing, they go back home. And I don't think that's that type of attitude is going to survive.
Yeah, you have to stay connected all year round. And I think that's one of the most wonderful things about the technology and the digital transformation these days is this ability. And it's why I'm so engaged with it and so passionate about it. I have been for an extremely long time since it first came out. It's just that ability to connect and to stay connected with people on a regular basis. And whether it's through video chats like this, or whether it's just on social media, of, you know, all the different brands and flavors these days of social media, but staying connected and continuing to ask questions and challenge your own thinking and to accept and to look at the way other people are doing corporate training and how they're solving their learning and development problems, and to be open to that, I think is incredibly important. So I can absolutely relate to the mind shift being first, because for a lot of folks, you're right. You're so right. It's hard for people to shift what they've been doing for sometimes 10, 15 years, learning that one tool and just being totally focused on that and not really open to seeing how content consumption, creation and consumption has changed over the years. And, you know, what does it mean when other people can actually start creating content? And maybe some people are doing it better and faster than you are, and they don't have,
or not even people anymore, but AI gets access to the content, the source content. So you don't have to ask for that PowerPoint or whatever anymore and reword that in a graphic left, text right format, because it's going to come out and the next day it's available. So what do we do then? What's the human aspect there that add value?
Yeah, I just saw a tweet from Donald Clark about a new initiative that he's doing, wildfire learning or something like that. I don't know if anybody in the chat has heard about that. But it's really interesting what he's doing with AI and being able to feed it large, large pages of text and turning it into into learning text. And to watch his video, hit up his website. I'll try to find his link and share it with everybody before the end of our conversation today. But just watching his video and watching him talk about it really blew my mind, because I'd been waiting for some of that stuff to happen because I see it with video right now. Have you seen now I can't remember the name of it, but anyways, I could take one of my blog posts, for example, and I could paste it into this this website, and it would automatically create a video for me. It would grab images that it thought matched sort of the key points of my blog post, put together a whole bunch of animated slides, basically, and text, and then you could go in. So it basically gets you like 80% of the way there. You go in, you make a few edits here and there, maybe change the music that they picked for you based on how the AI thought the feeling of the content was. And next thing you know, you just hit export and boom, you've got yourself a video based all on your blog post. And I that just came out last year, I think. And I thought, wow, sooner or later, there's going to be that button you click where you take a textbook or something and boom, it's going to instantly create courses and assessments, all that stuff.
But it sounds like, it sounds like the rapid authoring environment when it came out. So now all the crap can go faster into...
Yeah. They can make it production or worse. Right. But you know what I mean? I mean, instead of doing it the way we would do it, it would create either activities, or it would immediately, the AI would create something and send you information. I mean, it would choose the best method, right? Obviously, the best method probably wouldn't be how we consider rapid e-learning creation to be, but you know, it's going to do it better than we do. So then what?
So I think what I'm looking for in this whole AR in the ecosystem, that's another word that we have to use in this show, as long as it's indexed, because it's one of the buzzwords. But it does mean that once AI can have access to all these data sources, then we don't have to finally argue about, is it training or is it information? Because we spend so much time on wrapping up information and losing time on actually things that we could actually create something impactful that needs some kind of learning. That can be done very quickly overnight, as long as AI delivers that those channels that they need to be for each individual. And that takes off. It could take off our time and you know, off our shoulders. So we can just focus on what we need to, a more creative part or the more human part there's actually a deeper conversation needs to happen. Because I think what's not going to change is that if you request this information or training out there, nobody's going to ask you. AI probably wasn't going to come in and say, hey, do you really want to do this and why? And what else is going on? It's going to assume that what you ask is what you need, at least in the beginning. I'm sure that there's going to be learning curve here, and you say, Alexa, ask me the right questions, and then Alexa's going to ask the right questions. But we're not there yet, I think.
Yeah, we're getting close though, right? I mean, it's really just right around the corner. I don't know how, again, I don't know how perfect it's going to be, but I think what AI comes up with is going to be a lot different than what we've come up with, and it's going to shock a lot of people, but it'll be really effective. And to your point, it'll probably, because AI doesn't care. AI doesn't have any feelings. So if AI doesn't think that training is the solution, it doesn't have to worry about keeping its job or anything. It'll just say, nope, we're not making training. This is not the training will not solve this problem. We're doing something else. And it just won't do it.
and I think so this brings to the question whether we should have L&D at all as a separate identity, whether under HR or not, or people who know how to solve these problems should work directly with the business or parts of it. Do we really need to focus on like a centralized thing, which is not in my book at all. So it's, if you want to learn about that, we're not going to go all the way there. My book is really just the first hexad. So the point of this hexad is, it's because all games use hexad. You can tessellate and all that. But my whole point with these six things that you learn is that this is your first one. You put it out there, and then from each one, you can decide which one you're going to put more out there and learn deeper. So kind of build out your own game board in theory, which gives you resilience, because now you can move to different places, not just one tool. So it's just very beginning, thinking differently about the world.
Yeah, for sure. And I think everybody should check it out. I mean, if you're struggling with all of this digital transformation, if you've got a team, for example, that's struggling with getting on the same page, you know, I commend you in your efforts and being creative instead of just deciding to write a real dry sort of academic book like most of the books that are out there. I love that we've finally got a book in our industry that is creative and has a fun story to it. And like you said, even though, you know, it may feel like it doesn't wrap up at the end, I think the goal and all of the things that you should be taking away from, I think it forces you to think, right? It forces you to, you know, you're going to start asking yourself, hey, it just ended. And, you know, as opposed to having that satisfying feeling and going, yes, I got everything I need and I'm done. Instead, you're scratching your head and you're forced to think about it, right? And I think that's important. Whether you wanted to do it that way or not, I think it's a good
It's like, you know, it's like art. At the end, you take your conclusion and it might continue at some point. Who knows? Because it's just running out of time and not because that's the end of the book. But I do list a lot of, there's a lot of mental trips in it, what we call mental trips. So memories from my 20 something years and examples. So examples of when people asked for training and it wasn't, how do you handle that? Examples of when the solution was not what they asked for after all. How do you deal with SMEs who wants a confirmation of learning at the very end because otherwise they think it's not important because you have to force them to read every page? All these little things, a little bit of a different way of approach, but you can get something practical out of it and definitely a lot of laugh.
Well, that's the part that I love about it too, is that it has that creative element to it, but it does have those practical sort of flashback episodes. It's not like, I'll compare it to like, Who Moved My Cheese or whatever book everybody talks about, you know, where it's just so out there and strange. And you actually have to have a meeting with like eight facilitators to figure out how Who Moved My Cheese applies to you and your business. And, you know, maybe a psychologist in there to help everybody figure it out. I remember when one of my jobs asked us all to read it. And I remember reading it to myself, why? What? Why is this book all of a sudden like the best book ever and everybody wants to read it? So I appreciate all of the practical elements you've added to yours.
But at the same time, if you're really into the science behind these and research and how these things come from, So I, while I was researching, I read over 100 books, and they're all listed at the end. And I'll recommend each of them, so you can go in and, you know, get deep and read all about these things, if you're interested in it. What I didn't want to do is give you a prescription of these are the things that you need to do. You can decide which of these six elements, where you are with that, which is more interesting, and then go and go deep with that.
Yeah, perfect, perfect. Hey, listen, I forgot to mention to you at the beginning, we like to try to keep idiotic down to about 30 minutes or so. So let's wrap this up a little bit today and tell us where everybody can find you online and drop all that into the chat so people can reach out and connect. And where's the best place to buy the book so you get credit for that? Should they buy it on Amazon? Should they buy it directly from you? Is there a special link that people can buy it from? Or
don't buy it. So this is my number 12. Don't buy the book. No, no way. If you really want and you can't stand not having it on your shelf, then to go to Amazon. Don't search for the book title because there's an ampersand in it. And apparently you can search an ampersand. I don't know. AI should fix that. But if you search for my name, there's only one Zsolt Olah in the whole Amazon market. So here's my book. You can find me on Twitter. I'll put the credentials here and LinkedIn. I'm happy to connect with anyone. And if you know me, you know that I'm a good person to ask things because I actually reply and enjoy great conversations. Now, the only thing that I ask is don't send me long surveys. That's I don't deal with well. But other than that, I'm really happy to connect with anyone.
Yeah, which is fantastic. And I'll just echo those remarks to people. Zsolt is one of those people in our industry who comes to the table with a wealth of knowledge and experiences. And he is very, very giving of his time and his knowledge and sharing it with the community of professionals. So when he says that, he means it. If you have questions, if you're struggling with anything in the work that you're doing, obviously don't send him a real sort of academic treatise of sorts to review or anything. But if you've just got some questions and you want to ping him on how he might respond to a particular issue or question, I would encourage you to do so. This is what community is all about, and this is the social learning aspect of what we do. So one of the greatest things, I'll wrap up today with going back to the thought about, you know, leaving an event where there's so much content, and like DevLearn, and you go home or you're on the plane and you're burnt out and you're thinking to yourself, what did I learn again? A lot of different ways to activate all of that learning is to just simply remember the session or the speaker or the people you met, and then reach out to them and continue to have those conversations that started either via their presentation or, a conversation that you maybe had in the hallway, things like that. It's those conversations that really are great. And changing your mindset is going to be important. So whatever you do, don't buy Zsolt's book. Engage the world. But if you absolutely have to have it on your shelf, go to Amazon and look for Zsolt Olah. Thanks again, Zsolt, for hanging out with us today. Really, really appreciate it. Always a fun conversation.
Thank you for having me. And happy Halloween, by the way, everyone.
Yeah, you know what? I totally forgot about that today's Halloween, and I was mentioning it earlier. I think those of you that catch up with me on TLDcast, maybe I'll grab my Wayne's World costume and show up to TLDcast in the Halloween garb. But anyways, there's the music. That means it's time for us to go. I hope everybody enjoyed your coffee this morning and hanging out with myself and Zsolt today. Great conversation. I'm going to close out your video here and we're going to call it a day. Everybody have a great day. I'll see most of you again in an hour or so. But have a great day. We'll see you next week. Cheers. Yeah.